then followed by that, we then go to that of the quantification to choose which particular to have a higher efficiency. In that, chromolina gave an alkaloid level to be more, and then it contains the cystodavia, then the smodium, and bovaria recta. Then these are the compounds which has been chosen. Later on, we subjected to that of the phytochemical characterization, followed by the qualitative checkout, and identify the quantification based upon the bulk of the amount. We follow to that of the characterization protocol. So this is all we did with that of the phytochemical characterization. We did with that of the UV visible different spectrums. This is done in case of the Bohemia tomentosa. We checked out with that of the availability of these compounds, which is the getting on separation. The different concentration of the solvents we have been checked out, and this seems to be very effective in that of the ethanolic fraction. This is also very important when this particular compounds are extended for that of the drug discovery or by final entry. The amount of the content which is going to be entered can be assessed based upon the solvents what we are going to choose, rather than from the top excess to that of the final solvents what we are going to. So it's better to initial screening. We can work out from excess to the maximum available solvents where the compound can be extracted. So the bulk of the compound or the phytochemical we can get it will be more. So this is the structural characterization we did with that of the GCMS analysis, and these are the some of the compounds. Specifically we get nearly 20-30 compounds totally, but specifically a bulk of the compounds belong to a particular group, nearly flavonoids, and some belong to that of the alkaloids, some have specificity with that of phenols, that we compare with that of the specific standards and identify these are the specific compounds we identify to be, in case of chlorolina, it's to be 2-propylmethyl, 1,2-methane, and in case of the desmodium we got 4 compounds, and in case of Bohemia we got 5 compounds, and in case of Bovaria recta we got 2 compounds. These are the specific compounds which we have been characterized by means of our phytochemical characterization analysis. And followed by this, this is again my means of the HPTLC method, and this will specify which particular group our plant source contains a secondary metabolite, either a phenolics or it may be an alkaloids or maybe a terpenoids. This can be identified with that of this. So in case of the Todavia, we got 3-4 phenol compounds that we have been confirmed with that of the quercetin standard. Similarly, in case of the Vangitum, then we got flavonoids, and they have been compared with that of the specific flavonoid standards. Like that, we are compared with that of the standards to identify the group which is being potentially present on that of the particular plant sources. And this is, we have extended a study to that of the UV spectral analysis before and after derivatization, what is the difference you get on to that of the availability of the compound we detected. This is just a baseline peak to see the that is the concentration of the compounds present in your sample. This is for different 4 different types of the plant sources. We repeated the same process. This all characterization studies review, and this speaks again with use about the specificity of the different solvents we have used, and in that we have selected that this ethanol extract seems to be better in using for the top of further structural study analysis. And this FTIR analysis gives the specificity of the functional groups, right? And that is very much essential. Suppose if we recommend this to work on as a specific drug or target on the top of the specific receptors, how far they are going to be have an efficient effect on working, then we should know the specificity of the functional group that we can be isolated or located or identified with this. This may be helpful in drug designing and the discovery aspect. And these are the functional groups, because each peak specifies the availability of the functional groups present on, based on that we can identify. And this is again your NMR studies. And followed with this of the positive availability of these compounds and all the goodness of the antioxidant property. Now we have extended a study to that of experiment, that is the in vivo experimental studies using the rat as an animal model. Here we went on to again put on to a group to assess the acute toxicity study. And any in vivo study we categorize into 2 particular components as chronic and the acute. So acute will be a short term study, maybe from 7 days to 15 days to ascertain the possibility or the effectiveness. and this effectiveness comes as good, we can extend the study to that of the fraud. It depends upon, because all this is sometimes goes for that of months. So maximum we can extend to see the effectiveness and the positiveness of the drug, which seems to be non-toxic also, if we give for the long-term therapy, especially for that of the chronic studies. So the, I have grouped the animals into that of the 6 groups. Group 1 serves as a normal control, and group 2 with that of the, this is in case of your anti-inflammatory disease, induction of inflammation by means of the FCA induction. And the group 3 serves with that of the standard drug, diphenic, we are using. And fourth group is our plant extract, which is going to have the 2 concentrations we have worked on, one with that of the 200 mg per kg of the body weight, another with that of the 400 mg per kg of the body weight. Again, why we made a difference in that of having the concentration in that of the extract is that, again, to see the toxicity and non-toxic effect within that of the particular concentration. And it's a normal contest, any medicinal, any plant sources we are using as a environmental treatment up to 2500 seems to be non-toxic, but we cannot recommend directly to take that to be the maximum concentration. So we have to standardize for particular source how much is that. So this is to be non-toxic and effectiveness has been ascertained. So group 4 and 5 will be having the concentration of the, that is what plant extract in case of 200 and 400, and for group 5 will be acting only as a prophylactic. And this is about the HINPA, that is if you induce the inflammations after giving on the treatment of the plant extract, how far the recovery of the swelling has been gone down, and that is gives a positive indication our plant source contains the anti-inflammatory potential, thereby the swelling in the HINPA has been completely getting down. See, this is the photograph which gives on the control and the FCA induced, normal one, and the induction initiated. See, this is the normal control, and this is in case of arthritic control, and we are going to deal with that of the extract, plant ethanolic extract of the Bovia tomatosa, and this is with that of the standard drug difenic acid, the folinic sodium, which has been used as a standard anti-arthritic drug. Then we are using again with that of 200, and we have seen the reduction in that of the HINPA swelling with that of the, in this particular treatment. And this is about the hematological parameters, and this is in case of this, what is the changes coming across with that of the that is RBC, WBC platelet counts, and there is a quite good variations in that of, from that of the control to that of the what induced, that is inflammatory induced, and with that of the treated system there is a decrease, and later on they go for the restoration to that of the normal. This gives again a positive indication that the plant contains the anti-inflammatory potential. And this is the radiographic changes in the joints of the control, again in that of the bone. Because since we say it's an arthritis, rheumatoid arthritis induction causes a joint inflammation, how far this gets on to crippling and getting the recovery to that of the normal on treatment with that of our drug, that is in the plant extracts. And this is our histopathological analysis on in vivo studies with that of the cartilage, that is the part of the bone which has been taken from the foot. And we went on to that of the cartilages, and we see the control one, and this is an induction. Then after treatment with that of this drug, and we have the normal normalcy of this has been completely maintained. That again confirms that is the recovery and restoration of the tissue fractions has been achieved on treatment with that of this plant extract. So this is another work we have been working on that of the liver, right? Paracetamol induced liver damage. And we have ascertained that is the plant we have chosen called Desmodium gangeticum, which is possessing an hepatoprotective function and similar marker enzymes, and the study has been extended. Hematological, and here we have performed with the doctor specificity confined to the of the serum and also the liver markers, and there is a drastic decrease in that of the infected groups, and after treatment with the top plant there is a restoration in the top of the marker, again signifies the leakage in the top of the tissue cells has been regenerated, and there is normal restoration which gives an enhanced level. So again it signifies the protective function which has been present in the plant system. And this is about the hepatic markers of the control, and also the same to the compound which may be represented, that is identified by means of the characterization protocols. And again, this is about the histopathological section of the Desmodium, and this is the control group, and this is 250 mg of the group which has been induced with that of the paracetamol, and we are confined with that of the, this is not with the paracetamol, this is just to study the acute toxicity. We are increasing the concentration of the plant extract to see if there is any change with that of the liver fraction, and it seems to be non-toxic and better. The effect on the toxic marker enzymes, that is in case of the serum control, and that is control and the experimental rats. Here also we are able to see there is an increase in that of the second group, that is in the drug induced, what you call paracetamol induced damage, and there is a restoration in that of the treated group from 200 to 400 mg. And this is in case of the chronic study, that is the control one is without any normal rat, and two is the drug induced group, this toxicant group, and third one is that along with that we are making in this process, we are giving a co-administration, parallel administration of the toxicant drug along with that of our plant extract to see the synergetic effect, how far they have that. So from that of the 200, then we have a two concentration, and here with that of a standard drug, we compare how far our plant has the similar effect or positiveness, that has to be compared or checked out with that of a normal available allopathic standard drug. That also we are doing parallelly. So this is again in case of the acute toxicity study on the inflammatory anti-arthritic effect on the FCA in these rats. Similarly to the next plant, this is in that we are there again carrageen induced, and after treatment it gets on to a recovery. And these are the, some of the biochemical markers which has been taken into account when work on to that of the anti-inflammatory, that mainly to that of the protein, albumin, bilirubin, urea and creatinine in case of the plants. This is two plants for that of the acute toxicity studies we are taking. These two for that of the kidney function, to ascertain the nephroprotective effect, we are compared with that of the glomerulina and bovaria recta. This is kidney marker enzymes again. There is a decrease, increase, and there is a restoration compared to the toxic groups. This is biochemical markers, and this is histopathology again with the toxic control group, and this is for CR data with 250 milligrams and with that of 500 and up to 70, it all seems to be non-toxic. And similar in case of the Bovaria recta for kidney cells we have done. This is a chronic study extended, that is the damage induced to the top kidney, heavy metal induction by means of the lead acetate induced damage. And these are the kidney markers we have been working on with that of the ALT, AST, ALP and LDH. And this is about the biochemical constituents of the controlled experimental rats, we will compare with that of these two components, namely the CR data and the recta. See the level of protein in the group 2 getting reduced, and on that of the treatment it gets on a restoration. Similarly in case of albumin, bilirubin and all the biochemical markers getting altered. And this is the histopathology for that of the chronic study. Group 1 is the control rats, 2 is the lead induced damage to that of the kidney, so kidney tissue, then they treated with that of the 500 mg of the R data, and there is a restoration to normalcy, and similar with that of the erecta. And this is a compared with that of the standard drug called Silmaril. So coming to that of the conclusion, the concept of effectiveness and safety are the two prime factors to be considered for the use of any oral formulations, since dosage regime which has been standardized authenticates safe and protective effect of the medicinal plants. Thank you.
So what do you basically choose? Basically again what we all know, healthful foods, more of fruits, obviously more of raw fruits and vegetables, less of soups and less of juices and all the ready-made stuffs coming out of it. Emphasize more on whole grains and low glycemic index foods, because again glycemic index is a major contributing factor here. So educating people on what a low glycemic index food is or a high glycemic index food is, also I find as a medical professional that's the most important part. educating them about their disease, educating about them about different food, the importance of the combination of different kind of foods. So limiting fried foods, consumption of refined carbohydrates, that is refined flour preparations like your pastries and your junk stuff, including a combination of all of these. So more of when I speak about alkaline diet and a low carbohydrate diet now, including your greens along with a portion of protein source. It can be a vegetarian protein source or a non-vegetarian lean protein source which doesn't contribute to fat. Monounsaturated fats in your diet, which could be coming from your nuts, it could be coming from your olives, it could be coming from flax seeds or even fish oils, and whole grains. So this combination is what is required, not cutting out on any particular portion, because every food has its own contributing effect in our body, which we miss or which we don't realize. So no food is good or bad, but it's obviously the combination which is the most important. Limiting the consumption of red meats. And the most important thing that we forget again with non-vegetarian food, they require less amount of cooking. The moment you want to cook it for a longer time, they turn carcinogenic, burning the meat or putting them directly on fire. So these kind of things can really turn your non-veg food into carcinogens. So not doing those kind of preparations or taking care of the way you're preparing food, reducing your fat and salt intake. So oil intake, 2 to 3 teaspoons per person per day is what is the recommended oil intake, which goes to 1/2 liter oil per person per month, which actually if we try and see is more than required, but people don't again realize that when you directly pour things, it just becomes more oil. So I actually encourage my patients to have teaspoon measurements at their house to start with, so that they can get into a habit of measuring the number of family members and using the oil, and they realize that we don't really need so much oil. So it's basically making patients or cancer survivors or any situation or any medical condition, making patients more aware, giving them more knowledge and education, and also realizing where is the entire thing coming from. Like as I said, if it is stress or if it's an emotional issue, a lot of time just talking about nutrition doesn't help. And sometimes just nutrition education itself is a huge contributing factor in their lives. So for that, as medical professionals, I would personally say that we should spend some time with our patients, understand from where the situation is coming from, so that we can actually give them the right kind of treatment, especially when it's said that food is the first mode of treatment for any disease. Maintaining a healthy weight, obviously obesity has been directly connected to cancer growth. Choosing foods that will help you maintain the healthy weight. Educating patients about outside eating, again low calorie foods, about reading the food label, that again becomes very vital these days. Lot of foods have been marketed as low calorie or healthy or high fiber, but they are not really healthy in all senses. So educating, telling that low fat may not be really low calorie. So telling them about how to understand what's a calorie count, what's a fat count, really helps patients to make more sensible food choices. Preparing and storing food safely. Choosing more locally grown products. Using vegetables and fruits. Obviously, we have spoken a lot about use of pesticides today and organic farming, so not talking about it anymore. And which I already spoke about, marinating the protein foods to decrease the cooking time. Not touching more on the supplement aspect of it, this we have already spoken and heard about antioxidants today. So just few supplements that help cancer survivors could be vitamin D, omega-3s, probiotics and calcium. Now also researchers say that just depending on your antioxidant supplements is not the right way to do it, because it may not be just one particular ingredient from that food which is contributing. It's a synergistic property of these food or these agents which really shows the effect in the body. So not just depending on one thing, one external source of supplement, it's more from the natural sources. When we can't meet, that's the time the external supplement comes. What I also include is not that we don't depend on the biochemical reports. Along with that, I also depend a lot on muscle testing, which is kinesiology, to understand each patient's body's requirement. Like say for example, post chemo there's a hair fall. So by default we are given all the multivitamins which is required for a healthy hair growth. But more than that, I saw when I was personally testing, doing a muscle testing for their body to check which nutrient is required for their body and just recommending those particular multivitamins, they were showing better results and faster recovery from whatever their issue is. And also addressing emotional issues like depression, anxiety, fears, worries, anger in cancer patients, especially cancer survivors, when they're going through chemotherapy and going through their radiation. Addressing these kind of emotional issues and helping them come out of it has been even clinically research-wise proven that these kind of people can survive cancer much more than people who have not been addressed at their emotional front. So that's also one more thing which we cover in our clinics. So to summarize, it's more about making ourselves and our patients more aware of their body and the food choice. Thank you.
Whatever gets inside to get them out by our own means.
See, it's very important here to again see the combination of food that we are going to eat. Like, people might just eat a lot of refined flour preparation or have a lot of juices and think they can exercise and lose weight. They might lose weight, a lot of them do, but what people don't realize is what they're losing may not be fat. Okay, and that's how the side effects of weight loss happens, wherein you start seeing hair loss, dry skin, to the extent mood swings and insomnia. So it's very important. You can't use exercise to counteract nutrition. It should go hand in hand. Nutrition should be taken care of along with exercise. Thank you.
Nutraceuticals.
Yeah, absolutely. So as I said,
because all the natural food source alone, even they can be used as a therapy.
See, natural food source alone can be used as a therapy, but again, researchers, like say for example, soy has shown to help cancer. Okay, but lots of time, again, researchers doesn't say that a soy-induced protein or a soy-induced supplement can really help you with cancer. So here, that's the most important thing where we talk about having more of the original food. And again, a lot of time, nutraceuticals are marketed in some way.
So basically on that of the diet, what you recommend, what you have shown that...
Absolutely. So that's where the supplements comes in, wherein I said post the diet, definitely. So if it's required additionally, yes. But what happens these days is a lot of people depend on supplements cutting out on the diet. When we speak about what about fruits, where is the phytochemicals, where is the antioxidants? They're like, oh, I'm taking vitamin C, oh, I'm taking vitamin A. That doesn't
supplements
help.
Supplements comes from only on that of the specific deficiency or on what you recommend. But as far as the diet is concerned, if it has been planned and properly given, on all the nutrients will be entering inside.
Yeah, so absolutely.
I recommend that to be a more efficient one rather than going for that of the supplements.
Right, so that's exactly what I'm saying.
I have compiled a book on nutraceuticals, the future safe medicine. It has been published in that of Lambert's book company in 2008. So, any references, you can refer to that.
Okay, thanks. So, with children, it's majorly one. Children, how they learn things. First, right from infancy, it's been recommended that from 4th or 5th month, you can introduce soups to children, which a lot of time is not done. It's more dependent again on an artificial source of food. So when their taste buds get used to a particular food right from the infancy, the acceptance of that food increases. So they easily take it. Secondly, you know, a lot of parents come to me and tell that my child only eats chocolate or these kind of things. So I always ask them, so who introduced them to chocolates? So it's we who do it in the first place. It's we who give them when they demand it. So as a parent, we have a certain role. You have to be the role model, telling the child about healthy food, teaching. That's where you need to be informed. You know, we need to tell our children about why we should eat this, what's the property of this food, how it will help them in their body. And every child wants to be healthy. It's a natural instinct to be that. But it's we who don't do it. Parents, especially in Bombay, wherein I've seen parents, they force children to have aerated drinks. And I'm like, what are you doing? So that's where, you know, we have to be the role models. And you have to play a role wherein, okay, you have to have your vegetable to have that chocolate. So we need to address why people eat more, when it is stress, when it is bored, when it's emotion. A lot of time, a food gives you a satiety feeling or it fulfills a particular emotion in your life which is missing out. So people choose food over that emotion.
But when he said, when I'm sitting alone at home, not doing it the weekend, you tend to eat more. You're bored.
So we will give you a number. Please visit our clinic.
Number three, what I find is because when you eat, normally, as you said, I listen only half of the things. People eat fast because there is a vagus nerve which goes there, which gives you the signal. But if you eat slowly, then you know when you are full.
Yes, I think you missed that part where I spoke about it. So we did speak about mindful eating, meditating over your food, being more aware of the senses, enjoying your food. Automatically with that, I have a workshop completely on this aspect of it. Automatically, I give each participant of the workshop a full bar of dairy milk, and most of them, there are overweight loving chocolates. But it's a 3-4 hour workshop. The way I ask them to eat that dairy milk, at the end of the workshop, 98% of people have only had the 2 small pieces of the dairy milk from the entire bar and the rest is left out. Wherein these are the people who can like at 4 hours finish an entire bar. That's because when you eat less, when you're eating mindfully, when you're eating with all your sensory organs involved in that food, your satiety comes earlier and you're full earlier. So you automatically don't indulge in overeating and you feel very satisfied with what you've eaten. Or to the even extent of fussy eating, like it can be the father figure or even anybody, the child looks as a role model in the house, fussing about why this vegetable, why it's prepared like this and it shouldn't be made like that, and the child starts getting more fussy with these kind of foods in the house. So it's important that we do encourage eating with the family, at the same time not passing negative comments about food in front of children while eating, because they quickly pick that up. So the ones who are doing the research on the alkaline diet, they are claiming you should eat more than 80% of food only alkaline, cutting down on the 20% of acidic food. And again, when they are talking about alkaline food helping you to kill cancer cells, what I said is, I'm not saying it doesn't work. What I'm saying is, they're not considering, is it just the alkaline property of that particular food, or is it few other phytochemicals, antioxidants with that in that food which is helping that particular, you know, claim that they are making.
I have a comment on your diet. Which, you have included non-vegetarian food. I don't agree with you because basically I agree with the gentleman who spoke this afternoon on natural hygiene. See, they have proved that if you just consume fruits and vegetables, you can avoid all diseases. You will have a long span of life, healthy, without any disease. So I don't basically agree with you.
So first thing is, I didn't talk about a complete food guide pyramid. I only was majorly focusing on these two diets, which doesn't talk about the food guide pyramid altogether. So that's where the non-veg protein part came in, because alkaline diet and acidic diet had to mix and speak about it. Secondly, it's not that I encourage, but neither do I discourage. But at the same time, there is a choice. That's where the personal time with each of the client is involved, seeing how each body works. There is also a second theory to the entire aspect of non-veg food, which says that we, when, as we have been progressing from our ancestral times, as human beings, we were hunters first. So that's where the ones who were. Right, so, it started with hunting and all that, so body is used to it. So it's not that I'm propagating it, but at the same time, I'm not anti it. Thirdly, as she rightly said, the kind of non-veg that you eat, the way the food has been, the animal has been treated, yeah, that makes a lot of difference. So it's not that I'm propagating any particular thing. I'm not doing that. So it's all, food is a theory which is a long topic of discussion and we can go on. So like even if we talk, we can talk about vegetables not being healthy because of the pesticides. We can talk about every particular food and say how it can be healthy, how it can be unhealthy. So here, more than going on the negative aspects of how something can be more, not so great, because then people are lost with what do they choose. I went on more of how combinations are most important and how education is most important to patients, because we all here, I know you all most know so much about the diet aspect of it. I didn't even have to speak about eating vegetables and fruits. So the aim was more to educate patients, see how personally each of their body works, see how their choices are, see what the root cause is, and to then deal with that particular issue. So I'm not propagating any particular thing. It's only because it was a comparison of alkaline diet and the low carbohydrate diet, I said that combination. Oh,